But we just want you to prepare your hearts to receive the word of God. This morning, Brother David said that the Lord had spoken to him and he wanted to share something that God had given him. And I believe this is going to be a blessing. I want to encourage you ministers, and you know, it's kind of difficult to make a schedule and one this Sunday, one the next Sunday, and all of that. But I would rather for you to feel led and you come to me and you let me know that you have a word from God. And I believe this is a word today that's going to bless us and to encourage us. Brother Damon and Sister Shante, they have proven themselves as being committed, and I trust them. You know, he said every prayer I need. He said everybody wants to hear everything that we have. So this is a serious brother, and he has really made a commitment. And I appreciate the commitment that this family has made. And we have been a real blessing to this ministry. So let's all stand wherever we are. Let's receive the blessings of praise the Lord.
Praise God, we got an awesome pastor, first lady. Man, they've truly been a blessing to me. I'm sure they've truly been a blessing to you. And so let's go ahead and get dive off in. If you bow your head for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, for its life. Gives healing to the flesh. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that our minds are being renewed by your word, Lord God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the individuals here. Make the ground that's here, Heavenly Father, ready to receive, Lord God. And they'll go home, they'll take the word home, Lord God. They'll study to show themselves approved, Lord God. They'll water the seed that goes forth today, Heavenly Father. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, for the increase that you give us, Lord God. Prosperity. Prosperity. Soul prosperity, Heavenly Father. So we thank you that they're prospering and be in good health, Lord God. Because they're staying on you, Lord God. So we thank you for our decrease that you increase. And I'm careful to give you alone all the glory. All the honor and all the praise. In Jesus' name, and all agree with that prayer said. Amen. 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 And so one of the things God has given me, just really staying in prayer. One of the things he showed me is that we've been complacent. We've been complacent as a church. And so we've kind of gotten fat. We've gotten some good word. We got some good teaching. It was kind of funny. I was cleaning out my car the other day. And I had 11 books that Pastor had written. Specifically as it related to different areas in your life. And it was amazing to me because those books were older books. Those weren't even new books. They were older books. And I said, boy, we've got a lot of word inside of us. And I spoke with Sister Deborah maybe a couple weeks ago, and I just thanked her for the prayer session that we had, her being obedient. And I told her, I said, you know, it's important that we have that prayer. It's important that we pray and fast. Now, I was brought back to the remembrance of the parable where he said, these things come out through prayer and fasting. And it was Jesus just cast the devil out of a young man, the demon out of a young man, and the disciples couldn't do it. And he said, these things come out through prayer and fasting. And he wasn't particularly talking about demon, he was talking about doubt and unbelief. Doubt and unbelief. And so it kind of brings me to what we're going to talk about today. And that's the spirit of the Word of God. the spirit of the word of God. And so when we begin to pray and fast, I liken it to adrenaline. You can eat and get fat. And you all know I'm an ice cream eater, so sometimes I eat, and late at night I might go get me some ice cream, and, you know. And when I do that, my wife say I breathe hard. Right? And I think what's happening is we've eaten a lot. We've got fat, and we can't get our bottoms out of the pew. And so I heard Brother Hagin say this one time. He says, the word is like eating. You got to eat in order to live. But he said, prayer and fasting is like breathing. And so you can eat and not breathe, and eventually you'll do what? You'll die. And likewise, you can breathe, but if you don't eat, eventually you'll what? You'll die. And so what I realized through prayer and fasting is prayer and fasting is like breathing. It'll get you moving. See, through prayer and fasting, that doubt and unbelief. See, it doesn't matter that you eat the word. See, but if you don't do anything with it, I believe Romans 11:1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, which is the word. See. And the evidence of things not yet seen is you doing something. See. And so what the church has been missing is the element of prayer and fasting. How many of you all know when you don't exercise and you eat 3 meals a day, you get like me, you get... But when you're exercising and you eat 3 meals a day, the doctor tells you what? Your metabolism increases. And I believe the metabolism within the church has to increase, and that first starts with the spirit of the word. Are y'all feeling me? Now, how many of you all know we are a spirit? See, we live in a body, and we have a what? Soul, right? But the element of spirit I want to talk about today is not necessarily who you are. The spirit I want to talk about today is your attitude. The spirit I want to talk about today is your attitude pertaining to the word of God. And so if you got doubt and an unbelief in you, then you probably going to be stuck to the pew. Right. And so how many of you all know that today is Super Bowl? See? And so for those Panther fans, I'm a Panther fan, right? So I'm going to get jiggy with it. I'm going to get live with it. You follow what I'm saying? When I'm watching the Super Bowl, I'm going to talk stuff, you know. See? Why do I do that? Because I got into the spirit of the ball game. Booker T, when you go see Booker T play, you get into the spirit of the ball game. I remember I was at Broken Arrow a few weeks ago, and I was watching. I called him my nephew. He was playing. And I swear, I've never been in a basketball game where it was like I was in church. I mean, literally. Nobody was cheering. Nobody got excited. It was just like, blah. Right? Right. And that's pretty much the attitude that the team has. It's the attitude that the coach has. It's the attitude to, and it trickles down. Right? And so when this, I believe that the spirit has been taken out of the church. How many of y'all know that the enemy comes, the thief comes to what? Steal. Right? Now watch this. Watch it. The enemy comes to steal. What does he come to steal? He comes to steal the word. And when he steals the word, he can kill you what? Spiritually. And then once he kills you spiritually, he does what? He destroys your life.
So we got to get this spirit thing right. We got to get this spirit thing right. And it starts with the soul. Starts with the soul. I know you guys are going to get tired of me preaching this one verse, but when we get it right, I can go on to something else, right? Praise God. Turn in your Bibles to Matthew 22. Verse 37. Actually, go up to 36. This is Jesus talking. It's in the red. It's in the hot sauce. Matter of fact, verse 36 says, Master, who is Jesus? Master, right? When you get born again, you what? Confess with your mouth that Jesus is what? Lord. So he's your master. You're going to follow hard after Jesus. That's what you confess, right? He's supreme in what? Authority, right? Master, which is the great commandment in the law? And Jesus said, that thou shalt what? Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart. That's the spirit man. With all thy soul. That's the will and the emotions. And with all thy mind. See, that's the intellect and imagination. See? Now, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the Super Bowl. There's no doubt and unbelief that the Panthers are not going to win. See? I'm trying to give you something that you can kind of relate to. There's no doubt and unbelief that the Panthers are going to win. Right? So you can't come talk to me about Peyton Manning. You can't come talk to me about the Broncos, right? Because I'm 100% convinced that the Panthers are going to win. So now, let me ask you this. When somebody presents you with something that is opposite of the Word of God, when situations and circumstances dictate something other than what the Word say, are you 100% convinced, see, that the Word of God is true? Do you speak the Word? Not only do you speak the Word, but do you speak the Word with fervency? See, do you speak the Word without doubt and unbelief? See, that's what Jesus did. Jesus spoke the word without what? Doubt and without what? Unbelief. And what did he become? See, he became the word. See, that's essentially what we want to get to. We want to what? Become the word. See, and the truth is we are the word. We just don't believe it. It says, this is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, that thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And on these two commandments hang everything. Hang the law and hang all of the prophets. Where does it start? It starts here with love God with all thy heart and with all thy soul. This second part, with all thy soul, underline it. It's the only place in scripture where the soul is distinguished between will and emotions and the mind, the intellect and the imagination. Everywhere else you see the word soul, it puts all of it together. The will and emotions, the mind and the intellect. What's interesting is this dictates your spirit. What I mean by this dictates your spirit, I'm not talking about the spirit man, I'm talking about the spirit of the word. The spirit of the word. When Jesus spoke the word, everyone was 100% convinced that he meant what he said and it was going to come to pass, even when they didn't understand it. Turn over to 3 John. Verse 2. It says, beloved, I wish above all things. Beloved, he's talking to you or the church. I wish above all things that ye may prosper and be in health, even as your what? Soul prosper. Until you get into the spirit of life, you will not prosper and you will not be in good health. Are y'all following that? The spirit of life. The spirit of life. That means you ought to get excited about the word. Scripture said the joy of the Lord is your strength. What is he talking about? The joy of what? The word is your strength. See? The joy of the word is your strength. See? If you can't pay the bills, what does the Bible say? He said he'll make you the what? Lender and not the borrower. So do you get dismayed about the fact that you can't pay the bill? Or do you get excited about the fact that he's about to do a sudden? The scripture says, according to your faith, that it be unto what? You. The only person hindering you from receiving is what? You. I'm going to give a little testimony because God is showing me some things as it relates to finances in this church. And so I'm going to share with you a couple testimonies. Me and my wife, we were getting married. Matter of fact, there's a few young men in here, so I'm going to calm down. I wouldn't ask my wife to marry me because I wasn't Boaz. Do y'all follow what I'm saying? Let's say I wasn't Boaz. I wasn't rich. You know. And so I was waiting on things to come in before I proposed to my wife. You know. And I think sometimes, you know, I heard Brother Hagin say this. He says, you know, you err on the side of caution. And I heard it, and it's really become the anthem of the church. Now he gave a statement. He gave error on the side of caution. He gave that statement. And we made that the anthem and not everything else he done preached about. And so what we as a church do is we err on the side of caution. We don't go all the way. We didn't take the scripture and the fullness and then take it right back in the next sentence. Even the young people got a song that say we go hard or we go home. And so the church has to get into that spirit. We go hard or we go home. Because if you don't go hard, you're getting in the way. Why? Because we're all members of one body. And so since they were going hard and I'm taking it easy, then I'm getting it since the devil's way. Does that make any sense? I'm getting it since the devil's way. And what I was doing was I was getting in my wife's way. I wasn't going hard. Matter of fact, her mama pulled me over during Christmas. And she said, So what you gonna do? She did. I went home with her one Christmas. And her mama, she pulled, she said, "Now, nah, I'm gonna move to Oklahoma. What you gonna do?" I told her, I said, "Mama, I'm working on something. I'm working on it. She said, "Well, you better work fast." And so God had to deal with me, and God said this to me. He said, "I want you to look at every great man and woman in the earth today." And he said, "I bought every single one of them from nothing." From nothing. See, when you look at the great man of God in the faith camp, they didn't come from an inheritance. I'm talking about they didn't come from wealth. They came from nothing. Starting from the bottom, now we're here. You understand what I'm saying? And so I had to get this thing. And so I said, "Well, I'm going to Cracker Jack box. We're going to do whatever we got to do to put a ring on her finger." I'm serious now. So I went to Woolies. I said, "Let me get a band. But my wife likes a little bling bling, so give me something with a little something." You know? So I bought this ring. I got engaged Christmas, the Christmas banquet, right? On the podium, Pastor Hagen got to, and she said yes, praise God. So she said yes, but I noticed the way she looked at the ring when she got it. I'm telling you the whole story, so we eventually gonna get there. So I realized I gotta do something a little different between now and wedding day. See? But what it did was it increased my faith. Right? When you love somebody, right, you move on something. See, even Jesus said, "If you love me, you'll keep my commandments." And so my wife didn't care what type of ring she had. I saw the desire of her heart when she looked at the ring. And it, you know, I wasn't there yet, you know. And that's okay. That's okay. So I said, "God, we got to do something about this." So I go to Moody's. Actually, no, I didn't. We have I sold a seed is what I did. We had a winter Bible. So every day of winter Bible, I emptied the check count out. My wife don't know that, but every day. You know, I put a little bit in, put a little bit out, every day. As much as I had, I gave. So I go to movies, and I say, "Man, we got to do something about this ring." So what I did was I designed the ring for her. And it was a half carat. Now, I couldn't go too far, but, you know, working on it. So I designed this ring, and it didn't have a centerpiece. Just the band was a half carat. Didn't have a centerpiece. And so as when they finished the ring, he called me and said, "Dale, I finished the ring. Come on, take a look at it." So as I'm looking at the ring, a guy comes in behind me. He said, "Oh man, that's beautiful." He said, "Can I get that in a carat and a half?" is what he said. So I kind of felt a little bad because, you know, he just flexed me, you know. but I wound up putting the ring on the payment program. I didn't purchase it then. I tried to prepay it. And so about 2 weeks later, I get this call from Moody's. And the guy that was there, he knew the owner of Moody's knows. He said, "Well, I talked to such and such, and he told me, he said the guy who came in and ordered that ring for a carat and a half, he said his wife didn't like it, he bought it back." And so I just wanted to call you to tell you, Dave, the owner said that he would give you that ring at the price of the half carat. How many of y'all know my spirit got to move? Got to move. So I'm paying for this ring, paying for this ring. We got married 7707. I hit the jackpot. Now don't go to the casino. So I got done paying for this ring in June. No, I got done paying for the ring in June. And so we get all the way till the week before the wedding. Now I got a caring to have band, no centerpiece. But I'm believing God. I'm believing God. I said, God, you said you'll supply all my need according to your riches. You didn't say according to mine. I said according to your riches. So I'm believing. 3 days before the wedding, my roommate comes down the stairs. Now, I didn't tell nobody this. How many of you all know some things you can't talk about with your friend? So my roommate comes down the deal. He said, man, God been dealing with me for a week and a half, man. And he pulls out this little jewelry bag. And he had gotten engaged before. And the young lady gave the ring back. Now he comes down the stairs with this ring. He said, man, I got to give you this, man. He said, man, the Lord been dealing with me for the last week and I don't understand it. I said, well, I do. 2 days before that, the guy from Moody's called me and he said, babe, you gotta figure out what we gonna do with this centerpiece because it's gonna take me a few days to match the diamond. I said, oh man, don't worry about it. He said, what you mean don't worry? I said, I got the diamond for it, don't worry about it. So when he come down the stairs, he give me this ring, it's on this little bitty skinny band, another carat and a half centerpiece. He said, Daddy, you got that. I don't know why I'm giving this to you. I said, I do. I know exactly why. So I called Moody's. I said, I got the diamond for you. I'm coming. It's funny because the diamond was a total different shape than any diamond in her ring. So physically, you wouldn't think that it would fit. Man, he took that diamond out, stuck it right in the ring. Perfect match. You know who that was? That was God. That was God. My wife also wanted a house. I wasn't planning on buying a house because I wasn't planning on staying. How many of you all know sometimes God got a different plan than your plan? And so I'm in prayer class. This is all before we got married. I'm in prayer class at Raymond. So I'm praying. And one of the guys that I played golf with, he said, man, call me as the spirit wills. So this whole day I'm praying. And he called this guy. So I get out of class and I call. That went on for 2 days. I get out of class and I call him. He said, Dad, you ready to buy that house? I said, man, I ain't ready to buy no house. Come on, I ain't buying no house. He said, well, just write down this address. I actually called him from in the classroom. He said, write down this address. I wrote down the address. It's our address now where we live at. I didn't have to go look for a house. You know what I'm saying? Huh? Now watch how God operated. We couldn't even afford the house. Now this is what's crazy about this house. This house 3,600 square feet, and it's just me and her. Nice house. And this is what God told me after I hung up the phone. I said, well, God, I know that Shante is leaving for a house. He said, well, just hook up with her. Okay. What does the scripture say about a husband and a wife when they hook up together? Can't no man put that what? A something. See, the enemy, when a husband and wife are on one accord, you learn this in marriage class, when a husband and wife are on one accord, see, can't nothing stop that. See, and I didn't understand it. I read it. See, but I didn't quite understand it, so we had to walk some things out. Had I not been in prayer and fasting, related to my marriage, I would have never been able to achieve. Well, God would never been able to achieve through me what He was able to achieve. So now watch this. This was in May. Now, I've never seen this happen, and I'm in real estate. I closed on this house in 2 weeks. We closed on this house in 2 weeks. My wife, man, she think big. She wanted a big wedding and everything, you know, reception. I ain't have no money, you know. So we walk in this house with about $28,000 in equity, and the guy writes us a check for $6,500. I didn't have to go seek that. I saw first what? The kingdom. And He added all of these things on to me. Right? Because I was fervent. I was fervent in my prayers. And He said, when you hook up with your wife, there is nothing that y'all can't do. So my spirit, the spirit that I had changed. What is your attitude concerning this word? What is your attitude concerning the word? He said the heart of the king is in what? It's in His hand. See, now watch this. Because of the death, burial, and resurrection. See. Each one of you are kings and priests. When are you going to turn it over? Matter of fact, the song before I got up said, well, I surrender what? All. When you surrender all things work up to the good of those who what? And are called according to what? Even the money say, and God, we trust. Don't trust in stuff. Stuff won't get you nowhere. Don't trust in your situation and your circumstance outside of what God has to say about it. I'm trying to teach you how to prosper. Spiritual laws work even when you're not born again. Spiritual laws work even when you're not born again. If you notice what we call successful people in life, they got certain spiritual laws under control. We have to get to that point. We got to get off this pew, on our knees, in fervency, fast. Put this flesh under what? Subjection. Stop yielding to the flesh. Matter of fact, the word, the scriptures say what? That the word itself is healing to the flesh. He will redeem the time. I was talking to my dad the other day. And my dad said to me, man, I sure wish I would have done some things differently. My dad went 36 years without a promotion. He went with promotion and pay, but he didn't want to get involved in the politics of policing. Sheriff's Department, 36 years, Wayne County, outside of Detroit. So he's seen it all. And he said to me the other day, he said, Dave, I wish I would have did some things differently because we could have lived a better life. And what I said to him, I said, Dad, it's okay. I said, I got Jesus now. And you got Jesus now. Right? But what I said to him is, I said, if you would have had those things that you said that you wish you had back then, I said, you would have never had the experiences that you have today.
That's right.
I said, Dad, don't worry about that. God had that. See? And but now God got you. And man, he just screamed. That's what he screamed. He screamed, hallelujah. Because now he's got a greater appreciation. See, if he would have got it back then, he would have never been able to experience what he experiences today. He will redeem the time. What you have to worry about is what you're going to do when. Right now. See, faith is what? Right now. Faith is what? Right now. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. See, the evidence of things not yet seen. Turn with me over to Romans chapter 12. Verse 1, it says, I beseech you therefore, brother, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living what? Sacrifice. Holy. Acceptable unto God, which is what?
Reasonable.
But here's the deal. Verse 2, it says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by what? That ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. See, who got to prove that out? You. He tells you what the promise is, right? He tells you what the promise is, right? He suffered the consequences. See, we've been over that the last 2 weeks. He suffered the consequences. He suffered the consequences so that you can experience this now. He wants you to experience this stuff. And people think that the gospel is hard. I don't get it. The gospel is what kind of news?
Good news.
Good news ain't hard. Huh? My lifestyle before I got saved, that was hard. You see what I'm saying? That was hard. After I got saved, buying a house was easy. I don't even remember if I got a pre-approval. I mean, to be honest with you. Huh? It was easy. Easy as Sunday morning. See, getting that ring was easy. See, I didn't have to slave. Huh? I didn't. Huh? The wedding, I didn't have to slave. I didn't have to work for that. It was freely given. See? Now, what's interesting, I'm preaching to myself, too. I'm remembering. You know what I'm saying? Well, because he said he'd take you from glory to what? Glory. So that's where he stopped me at. See what I'm saying? If that's where he stops me at, where will he take you? See, where he stops is where you stop believing.
Huh?
Where he stops is where you stop believing. See. Our first lady talked to us about tithing. How many of you all know tithing starts with your relationship with God? See? Abraham gave because he what? He loved God. See, when Melchizedek showed up, it was because he loved God and he gave 10% of everything he had. See? So your offering, see, I'm talking when you got money in the bank. You follow them, if you ain't got it to give, then you don't have it to give. But your offering, if you got it to give, is dependent upon your relationship with God. So one of the things that our first lady kind of put on me last week was she said, tithe your time. Man, that just stood out to me. If y'all don't know what your time is, the day is 2 hours and 24 minutes. Tithe your time. Spend 2 hours and 24 minutes with God and then watch and see what he does for you. Watch and see what he does for you. See, he'll get that adrenaline moving. See, he'll get that adrenaline moving. See, and then you won't be in front of the TV watching, you know, your scandal. I'm meddling now. See, you take two hours and 24 minutes and you spend that time with God every day, let me tell you something. Your job will change. See, where you dwell will change. I heard Brother Winston say this, in order to live on another level, you got to eat on another level. In order to live on another level, you got to eat on another level. Are y'all ready to go to the next level? Pastor, ready to go to the next level. See? But because of the complacency that has hit the church, see, he got to hold up weight. I even heard Brother Hagin say this plenty of times. He got to get word. He said, I can't tell him. They got to get the first step first. Are you ready to go? Huh? Are you ready to bust out of these four walls? You ready to get a bigger church? Now, when you get a bigger church, because I watched this transition too, you can't get comfortable. Sometimes we get to a point where we arrive. You got a nice big house, you comfortable, you arrive, you know. No, I want more. See? Why do we want more? So that we can bless more. See, what did that prayer say, Brother Travis? I'm a distribution center. How long did y'all hear that? I'm a distribution center. See, a distribution center ain't got no lack. It keep coming. Truckloads. By the truckloads, it keep coming. Huh? Keep it coming. Why? Because I'm keeping it flowing. I'm keeping it what? Flowing. See? What the song say? I want overflow. See? When you got overflow, somebody else gets blessed. See? Don't get comfortable. Don't get comfortable. Where's the spirit at? Get comfortable in the home team, the kingdom of heaven. Amen. See? Don't listen to what the other team is saying. Huh? You know when you go to the basketball game and you sitting on the visitor side. See? Some people get scared on the visitor side. They forgot where they came from. You know what I'm saying? They get on the visitor side and get scared. Nah, I'm going to go crazy whether I'm on the visitor side or I'm on the home side. You understand what I'm saying? You are ambassadors of the kingdom of heaven. Wherever you go, your side wins. You are ambassador. Do y'all know what the word ambassador means? Huh? You represent the kingdom of heaven as a king in the earth. God has given you the authority. God has given you the keys, the authority to dictate to situations, circumstances, what he promised. The authority of the believer. I think Pastor's going to do a series on the authority of the believer. He's giving you the authority to establish his kingdom where? On earth as it is in heaven. Woo! When we we start getting our mind renewed to that, man, we ain't gonna have a problem getting folks saved. Jesus didn't have a problem getting folks saved. The disciples didn't have a problem getting folks saved. Healed. The Joker was begging, got healed, never came back. Silver and gold, I have none. They had plenty of silver and gold, but that wasn't what he needed. Silver and gold I have none, but that which I do have, pick up your bed and walk. He walked off never to beg again. And that was just milk. He ain't even get to the meat yet. That was just milk. The sincere milk of the word. Heal your body. Praise God. How many of y'all ready to prosper? Seed time or seed water harvest. Seed, that's the word, right? Water, that's studying, right? And prayer, fasting, right? Harvest. Seed, water, harvest. Are y'all ready to harvest? Huh? Are you tired of being complacent? Huh? Are you seriously tired of being complacent? Prayer and fasting. We're going to see you on the 3rd or 4th. On the 27th, prayer and fasting, 8 to 12. Let's get that adrenaline moving. Huh? Brother Lister say, I'm like S-Lax. I come to get you moving. Huh? We come to get you moving. Get all of the stuff you don't need out. See? Get all of the stuff that you don't need out, right? And let's get you moving. Huh? With some swag. You understand what I'm saying? Huh? The Holy Ghost is swag. It's swagger. And it's attractive. It's attractive. How many of y'all got something out of this? Huh? Are y'all ready to get moving? Huh? Praise God. I hope that blessed you. Anybody here for a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your word, Lord God. We thank you for a sweet spirit. We thank you for a humble spirit, a meek spirit, Lord God. But we thank you for excitement. Excitement. Excitement in our prayer closets. Excitement in that tithing of time. Excitement in our offering that we give to the church. Excitement, Heavenly Father, that we are your workmanship. You are the head. We are the body, Heavenly Father. And we just thank you, Heavenly Father, that because we're the body, we're not separate from you. You're not a character. You are in us. We are in you. You are seated at the right hand of the throne. And we're seated there in you, Lord God. So we thank you that you continue to send petitions to your Father, to our God. That we can accomplish your will in the earth, Lord God. Establish your kingdom as we walk in this earth, Lord God. Continue to write your laws on our hearts. Continue to write your laws on our minds. We thank you that our soul is prospering. We thank you that we're prospering, that we're in good health. We thank you that we're operating in the ministry gifts, Heavenly Father. to affect change in others, Lord God. We thank you that we understand that the enemy is not winning, that you're winning. You're winning because we're getting off the bench. Oh, hallelujah. We thank you that we're going to the fields. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that the workmanship that was small is now beginning to become vast. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that we're becoming more and more and more about your business. We thank you that souls are being saved. We thank you that the anointing is destroying the yoke and lifting the burdens, Lord God. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that you're sending people this way, Lord God, to receive the fullness of who you are. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that your kingdom is advancing and that the numbers are growing exponentially, Lord God. We thank you that you chose us to round this thing up. So we thank you for the increase in your kingdom. We thank you for the increase of finances. We thank you for the increase of love. We thank you for the increase of good health, Lord God. We thank you that you're not coming back for a church in Latin, but you're coming back to a beautiful bride, ready to receive her husband. Oh, hallelujah. We thank you for the many blessings that you bestowed upon us. In Jesus' name we pray. All in agreement with that prayer today.
Amen.
Amen. All right, was that great? Amen. Yeah, good word. Good word. All right, that was preparing us for our conversation. A lot for everybody to spend. And we want you to make your way down to the front. Just want to serve communion, brother. You can come, you can come. And the Lord has laid on my heart, Brother David paved the way, and I believe that was the Lord leading him to share the importance of us really beginning to get serious, get out of our complacency. The Lord had laid on my heart even before Sister Deborah convened her fourth Saturday for our prayer, that there are some things that God wants us to do to prepare ourselves for that consecration. First of all, we want you to commit to being there. There are some meditations, the things that we want you to begin to start speaking. We want you to begin to build yourself up. We don't want you to come on the fourth Saturday empty. And we focused on this Wednesday night. And we're going to do, going to put everything in your hand that we possibly can for you to begin to start saying, coming into agreement with the Word of God even before the fourth Saturday. Then we want to have some pre-fasting times, even before that fourth Saturday. We just don't want to walk in a consecration on the fourth Saturday with all the potentials. Because I really got blessed last fourth Saturday. I was blessed, but I was already full of the Word and full of the Holy Ghost. And my cup just ran completely over. I want you to come down. I want you to make a commitment. Amen. I want you to be in prayer tomorrow night, Wednesday night. We want to see more of you here because we want to give out the information and explain it. There are things you need to be saying with your mouth in agreement. If you really want to receive God's best, you have to begin to call the things that be not as though they are. something has to come out. God can only work with what you give him to work with. Amen. Praise God. And we want you to be blessed. We want you to come up. There's no need of us not receiving the full measure of what God wants us to receive. If we would just participate, hook up with what God has in store for us. What? Amen. Praise God. We want you, hallelujah, to praise God, to place yourself in a position where God can show himself strong on your behalf. We want you to come down. Everybody come to the front. We want you to make this commitment. Amen. We want you to get this information in your hands by Wednesday night. Amen. Everything basically that's important to you to prepare yourself, the prayers and all of that, even the music, we want you to begin to sing. Amen. The word can be instilled within you as you begin to sing the words of songs that are in agreement with the word of God. We want everybody, amen, praise God. We know that 3/4 of you don't come to Bible study. You know, that's one of the reasons why it's kind of difficult, amen, to get the breakthrough in, for us to accomplish things in the spirit realm as we need to, because many times we are not here in prayer, we are not here in Bible study. Amen. And we want to put this information, if you're not going to come, if you can't come to Bible study, you can begin to build yourself up. Giving you step by step what you need to do in order to place yourself in a position where God can give you the full measure of the anointing and all that's needed in order to get your life where God wants it to be. Amen. It's going to be Wednesday night. Amen. You ain't never seen nothing like what I'm going to give out before. Amen. There are things you need to begin to start saying, speaking. Hallelujah. And we're going to give this out on Wednesday. As many of you, how many will commit to prayer? On Monday night. Amen. If you can't commit to prayer, Wednesday night. Lord, Wednesday night is going to be the night that we'll have all of this information ready for you. All right, Brother Williams, you're going to do your scripture, and then we'll go into commitment.
For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. The Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." Let's eat the broken body. Testament in my blood. This do you as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. Let us drink the blood. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the broken body, the shed blood, complete redemption in Christ Jesus, our Lord, on our behalf. Give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Let the Redeemer go over, let him say so. Hallelujah.
Everybody, just lift your hearts. Let's begin to praise. I'd like this for everybody, if you will. Hallelujah. And lift your heart right now. We just want to pray in the spirit of this one minute. Father, in Jesus' name, Shalom. Everybody, just lift your heart. Let's pray in the spirit. Thank God for what he has done in provisions. The redemptive work that he has made available to us today. How he has already delivered us from the power of darkness. But we need to begin to declare what he has done. We need to begin to declare who we are. We need you to learn that Satan's power in the middle of our lives have already broken. He's a defeated foe. We get delivered out of the kingdom of darkness. Oh God, Satan needs to hear this out of your mouth. Oh, hallelujah. The Spirit of the Lord, life in Christ Jesus, has already made me free. Oh, he needs to hear out of your mouth. He needs to hear you declare, hallelujah, that you are free, that the law of the Spirit of life has, hallelujah, made you free. Oh, Satan's dominion over your life has come to an end. But he doesn't want you to declare. He wants you to keep silent. He doesn't want you to pray the Holy Ghost. As Brother David said, hallelujah, we are saved and we are delivered by life. That's the reason David said, quicken thou me according to thy loving kindness. Quicken thou me according to thy word. Oh, thy word has quickened me. Yeah, la kama la ba ha ta. Every believer needs to speak praying in the spirit. Yeah. There are levels of praise that we need to be ascending unto. Yeah, ba ka sa ta da ba ha. He doesn't want us to just remain. Yeah, the same level. Not flowing and not glad tapping into all of the rich provisions. We want to be filled with the fullness of God.
To steal and kill, but Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and health.
Shalabasata. Lomabasata. Oh, I feel a little load in here. All right, brother David, you started something. Kesha Kashata. Hey, man, we're going to get on this dancing thing tomorrow night. Hey, we're going to start speaking and calling the things that be not. We're going to start that tomorrow night. Hey man, you need a breakthrough. You better take that brother David's message. Hold on. Hey, and we have a prescription for your breakthrough. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. Shalom, Hoko. How many thank you for the victory today? How many thank you for the victory? How many know the victory of my God? It's what comes out of your power. Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. We give you praise. We give you the glory now in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you that you have begun a good work within us. And you have begun a good work. We will continue to perform. We give you praise and glory right now in Jesus' name. Amen. You may take your seats. Father, we thank you again as we leave this place. We thank you for all that you have done, the word of God, and the anointing, the admonitions, and the ministries of those that came before us. Father, we thank you, and we believe that you are for us, and that you are showing yourself strong. But we just believe that this is just the beginning of what you have purposed. Amen, for us to receive on the fourth Saturday. But Father, we thank you in Jesus' name for all those that gave the gifts, the gift and the givers. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. We thank you, God, that we will reach our goal. We will, hallelujah, have out of the resources that we need will be forthcoming. We call the things that be not as though they are. We give you praise and the glory in Jesus' name. We just want every brother that hasn't fully obeyed God, and that we are down by, I think, 75 from 25. That's a whole lot of being down. All right, but somebody has obeyed God. Amen. God bless you. God loves you. God over there. Amen.